Divine Truth Assistance Group. These group assistance sessions are about putting principles of divine truth into action. This discussion is part of the Texas USA 2013 series. The topic is Leading Groups with Love, presented by Jesus and Mary on the 16th of November 2013 in Austin, Texas, USA. This is session 9.
Okay, well, our last day with you. And our last chat with you as well. We wanted to take the opportunity in this last day and last chat just to help you with a bit of direction when it comes to dealing with your dealing with the issues relating to groups, if you like. So that's probably what we'd like to talk about with you more. Could you just speak for a moment, babe, and I just might adjust our levels.
Sure.
First.
So, yeah, we know that a lot of you came to be here through a Facebook group. Is that right? Well, that's how you sort of found out about this. And we are not on Facebook ourselves, but we know that there's various groups on Facebook. And also...
Before you launch into that, sorry, can I provide a bit of background, or it's like a structure for what we're going to discuss?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So what do you know about the spirit world, or what have you been told about the spirit? You haven't been to the spirit world to know about it, so except in your sleep state, right? Yeah. And for most of us, that means we're in fairly confined space in our sleep state. So what have you been told about the spirit world that you sort of understand at this point? What have you been told? So if we look at it from the point of view of the spheres, what do you know about the spheres in terms of love? So if we use microphones, so we come around here, start at Gabriella. She's got lots of exercise happening today.
Intergalactic boundaries of love, I think you
said.
So
they're boundaries of love.
Yes.
So that means the more love we have, the more what? More room we have. We can go, if we have enough love to enter the third sphere, then we can traverse anywhere from
the first up from to our limit.
So even the earth.
You can go back.
Anybody
down
can
or
traverse
go up.
The earth, yeah. Mm-hmm. So here's the earth generally in the first sphere. So we can traverse the first, second, third sphere as well, right up to the third if we have that amount of love. Is that not second and first?
That's my understanding.
That's your understanding, right?
Yes.
Okay. So love is the primary requirement, basically, for the traversing of the spheres and giving you more freedom. Is that not the case? Okay. Now, if a person is in a poor condition and he can only be in the first sphere, and when I say poor condition, I'm referring specifically to God's definition of what the loving condition is, not his own, and he's in the first sphere, where can he go? He can go to the first sphere or he can surround the earth, can't he? He can't go to the second sphere. Okay? Is that not true? Okay. Floyd, if you want to ask a question about that. Sorry. No? You've got the rover right next to you.
We're talking after death or are we talking now in our life state?
Both.
Both, okay.
Yeah, so if you are in the third sphere and you go to sleep at night, your spirit body can go anywhere from the third sphere, second sphere, first sphere, or around the earth. Yeah. But if you're in the first sphere and you go to sleep at night, you will only ever be able to go around the direction of where the first sphere is, basically. That's the principle, yeah? Because it's the condition of love that determines where we go. Okay, so... how does that relate to the formulation of a group? Well, there's very big principles in that relating to the formulation of any group. Right? And what I'm going to do, and Mary's going to do, is we're going to go through how that relates to the formulation of a group. Does that make sense? Number two is that Cornelius, in his presentation, said a lot of things to you very rapidly. Right? And many of you have no idea yet how important many of the things Corny shared with you actually are. In fact, sometimes he made two statements in one sentence and you could have spent a good, 3 months discussing one half of that one statement. So what we'd like to do is get from Corny his original five considerations, if you like, and also ask you how that relates to the formulation of any group. But let's look firstly at this issue of love. If you make a Facebook group of your own, just a Facebook group, or you make any form, whether it's in a physical or typing or audio sense, what's going to be the governing condition of that group? If we go to Si.
The condition of the person that formed it, I would assume there has to be a connection there somewhere.
Good, so that's one. The condition of the person forming the group.
Would that condition possibility change as people joined if somebody else, if sort of leadership moved to that new person, would that change the condition or possibilities?
Well, of course that might happen if the person who decides to transfer the leadership to someone they notice is more loving, then of course that means the group becomes more loving. But if the person who's the leader decides that the person who's more loving needs to be criticized a bit because they feel a bit jealous of the person who's more loving, now the group has become even less loving than it was before. Does that make sense? And the other thing that we need to bear in mind is if the leader decides he's going to desperately hold on to the leadership of the group, even though he sees or she sees someone who's in a better loving condition than themselves in the group, then that in itself is going to cause the group to stagnate to a point, with one exception. And that is if the person in the more loving condition doesn't desire to lead the group, then of course they would not accept the leadership of the group. Does that make sense? Yep.
So that could actually happen irrespective of any formal declaration of change.
Correct.
Like it would just naturally, the group would naturally have a higher ceiling as leadership and responsibilities were undertaken, even just from a spiritual sense, not necessarily from a, I'm in charge now and so... Mm-hmm. Right? Yeah. Like it would be sort of organic, not...
Can be.
It can
but
be.
But it has to usually be the result of the decisions of some people.
Because if you think about your example, Si, if I'm having a group in my home and I'm the leader of the group, and then someone comes to the group who's in a better condition of love, but I don't acknowledge that, I feel like in your question you're saying, wouldn't they just naturally begin to lead the group? Or what would happen if they naturally did? Is that what you're asking? Mm-hmm. Well, this is what I was wanting to lead into at the beginning, is that Facebook groups and physical groups are not that... There's more similarities than you think.
They're identical, really.
Yes. So if we take the example in my home where I'm the leader and someone comes and they have a higher condition of love than I do, but I don't want to acknowledge it, who's going to lead the group? Still. If you just have the mic back, yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
The person who's formed it, because that's their, it's their group until they either they relinquish it or sort of move back and let it start evolving.
Yeah, or until they acknowledge that condition.
Yeah.
So this is where we have to be careful, where we go, oh, if more loving people come, it'll just naturally all work itself out. That's not necessarily the case.
Okay, thank you.
And in fact, what we've found many times, more loving people come and they get hammered by the group, which is a very common thing that we see observe on groups like Facebook groups or forums. And that's something, obviously, there's an indication of the poor condition of the entire group. Otherwise, they wouldn't hammer somebody that's new coming along to the group.
And perhaps we can explain hammering a little bit. You know, they're criticised, they're told that they're wrong, they're...
Pulled down. Most of the time, they revert to personal attack. Personal attack of the person's features, face, body, character, nature, like, you know, they always generally, people who want to pull down another usually revert to personal attack. There's not an underlying desire to help the person. There's an underlying desire to pull them the bits, basically, or and destroy
them.
To
control their presence.
Yeah. But we're skipping ahead of ourselves a bit, of fear of field, because firstly, the condition of the person forming the group is going to have a large effect on what happens at the group. Now, the person forming the group really is the owner. From God's perspective, any time you create anything, it's your responsibility. Does that make sense? So if you go and create a group just in your own home, from God's perspective, it's your responsibility what happens in that group. You can see you've now created a de facto condition where you are taking the responsibility of a teacher. It's a de facto condition. Even if you form a group and don't actually do any personal teaching, you're still responsible for that group, and also you are the de facto teacher in a lot of ways. Your example is going to determine greatly what people are going to do, feel like they can get away with, feel like they have to conform to. Your example is going to have a very large effect. So the person forming the group is a, you could say, de facto, if you like, teacher of the group through their example, in particular, number one. So A, through example, and B, through their actual words, their actual teachings, whatever they decide to share, through their sharing. And also, if we look at it, the person who forms a group has, from God's perspective, the responsibility for the condition of love. Does that make sense? So you form a group, you now have responsibility for its condition of love. Now, of course, because many of us have an injured condition of love, we don't know what that means. You know, we think that means, oh, as long as everyone's saying bartery things, I say, oh, you look lovely today. You have a lovely hairstyle today, darling.
You're such a great guy.
Yeah, and doesn't my shirt look very pretty? Your shirt looks very nice too.
You're just wonderful.
In other words, we're just complimenting each other. Now, of course, some of that might be true. I'm not suggesting any of that isn't true in this case. But can you see that if all we're doing is to exchange addictions with each other, particularly from an emotional perspective, not having a willingness to confront truth, not having a willingness to grow in faith, grow in the way we use our will, grow in the way that we become humble, and in particular grow in the way that we love, then all we could be doing is just having a, like, I was going to say some rude things, actually, but so I won't do that. But we could basically just going, you're nice, I'm nice, we're both nice, isn't it wonderful?
Or, wow, I worked through this emotion the other day.
Yes, darling, what was that?
Well, I had all this big grief with my dad and it was really good and I really felt really close to God afterwards.
Oh, that's so wonderful.
Yeah, what have you been working through?
Oh, well, I had a lot of, you know how it goes. So why do I even have to share my experience? If I really had it, I probably wouldn't even bother sharing it, unless it was going to teach another person something.
That's very different to someone saying, gee, I'm really stuck on this issue, and me thinking, wow, I was stuck on that issue once, and this is what I did. Here, let me tell you what happened.
Yeah.
That's very different exchange. Can you feel the difference in the exchange?
So looking so far at these particular facts, so let's assume now we wanted to start a group in our own home where we would just have a few people get together and we, you know, try to work through issues growing in love, you know, and we want to, and who knows what the program might be. We might decide it's all sorts of things involved. We might watch a video here, we might go out and watch a movie and try to connect emotionally to what they were saying. There's all sorts of things we could choose to do in the group, right? But the responsibility for the condition of love exists with the person who created it. The de facto teacher is the person who created it. Right? And the condition of the person forming the group is going to have a large effect on who comes. In other words, it's the condition of the person forming the group that determines what attractions primarily are going to be in effect in the group. Is that not true? The soul drawing people in. So if you're a male and you start a group and there's all these five angry women come along, that's your first group. What does that tell you? They're obviously angry with a male. You're the only male there, right? They're obviously angry with a male, and they've obviously got stuff to work through, but so do you. You know, so do you. The fact that you've attracted four angry women who are angry with men into your group is an indication that you are probably pandering to them. You're probably letting them get away with murder, as the saying goes. You know, that you're letting them get away with a whole lot of unloving things, and your initial attractions are there to show you what you're getting away with. Now, it's the same on Facebook. I create a Facebook page, and the very first people attracted to my page are all these people who are, you know, angry and resistive and, you know, want to boss me around and tell me what to do and all of those kind of things. So what does that tell me? It tells me I've got to work through a lot of issues about the receiving of all of that, what's actually going on inside of me. It's exactly the same Facebook or in person with regard to the group. Now, if this is the case, if these three things are the case, what do you do with a group? Is the question. Well, firstly, since the person forming the group has the responsibility for the condition of love in the group, it is imperative that the person who formed the group starts to understand what love would do. What would love do in any situation? Right? Because if the person forming the group doesn't know what love would do you think they're going to attract anybody into the group who knows what love would do either? Of course not. Right? So it's very important that the person forming the group has some self-analysis about what they believe love to be, has some analysis from God's perspective about what love actually is. So for example, angry person comes along to the group. So angry Mary comes along to the group. Right? Now, in your country, it's there. What's wrong? What's going on for you? You know, we spend more time with the angry person in most countries than we do with anybody else. Is that not true? Well, I call that pandering to the angry person. Right? Because if the angry person comes to the group, they're bringing along this terrible energy with them. Their own emotional energy is angry and resistive, right? And on top of that, they're going to be surrounded by spirits who also will be totally willing to use this person now to attack anybody in the group. Is that not true? So now I've not only got the person, but I've got their entourage to address, right? And it is my attraction. I'm the person creating the group. It's my attraction. What do I do? Now, you know what mostly happens? Oh, yeah, no worries. It's great to have a new member in our group. That means we've got two now.
We're so popular.
We've doubled our membership. So good.
I've got lots of friends as well.
Yeah, bring them along. Bring them along. Yeah. And then if the person gets really angry and says, I'm not going to come to the group again if you like this, we go, okay, I just won't be like that. You need to keep coming to the group. We start pandering to the person who is in the lower condition of love. Now, the reason why I brought up the way God organized the spirit world, if we've got a spirit in the third sphere of the spirit world and one in the first, can the first sphere spirit even get to meet with that person? How? No, he can.
Yeah. So how? Nice how. Yeah.
So, Floyd?
The one in the third
sphere. He has to come down and have a chat with him, doesn't he? Basically, that's what's got to happen. He's got to come down and have a chat with him. That's the only way they could even meet, is for the person in the third sphere to exercise some of his love to share with another person who potentially needs some help. So on Earth, it's not that's possible. A person in the third sphere and a person in the first sphere can meet easily, can I not? Yeah. So that's very much a possibility. In the third sphere, not possible. In your forums, it's possible for that to occur, isn't it? Yep. So how do you prevent it from occurring? So in other words, if this person comes along and they bring in all their anger, you know, rage, all of their condescension,
control,
all of their control, right, into your Facebook forum. Now, God's laws don't allow that person to do that in the third sphere. So what would you do if you were running your forum the way God's laws run? Would you allow that person in the forum? No, you wouldn't. And then what, say there were all these other people who were a little bit better conditioned, and you removed this person from the forum because of the condition, and then all these other persons attacked you for removing that person. What would you do there? Is a person who attacks another able to be in the third sphere? No, they're not. So what would you do? You'd remove them too.
It's just you and the group.
Does that make sense? But I guarantee it won't be just you and the group in the end, because you will have worked through some things and your emotions will have changed, and therefore your attractions will change. Does that make sense?
So you're ready for new attractions.
You'll have worked through some things. Now, if you don't do that, if you don't do what God naturally does with the spheres of the spirit world, if you don't do that, and remember, I'm not talking about this being your definition of love, I'm talking about it being God's, right? If you don't do that, what does it do to that location, whether it's a physical location or a location on the internet or whatever? What does it do? What does it do?
It brings it all down to the lower sphere condition.
Correct. So now we have a forum that really resides in the hills. And this is why many of the forums that people on the Divine Love Path start finish up residing in the hills. Because they just pander to all the people who are in an angry, hellish condition, right? Trying to bend over backwards to listening to them. And they don't get rid of either the people. When I say get rid of, we're not getting rid of them like cutting their throat. We're getting rid of them from stopping the influence of their lack of love on other people, right? You don't want to be a person, if you set up a forum or something in your own home, you don't want to be a person that just enabled a group of nasty people to come along to attack a group of other people who are nice. You don't want to do that. That would be the opposite of what God's laws would require of you. And yet that is what's happening most of the time on these forums. Does that make sense? So, Patricia?
Okay, this is kind of a big question, but as I understand it, God created the earth in a different way than the spirit world. Different things happen here.
Yes.
So is it that our goal is to change the way the earth works so that it's more like the way the spirit world works?
Well, that's certainly mine. I don't know whether that's yours.
Well, that's the option that God has given us.
Yeah.
It's under direct control of our will here.
Yeah.
See, more of God's will is exercised in these spheres.
So that's what we're trying to do
here. Yeah, we're trying to refine our will here. Or I am.
In the end, what we're trying to do... In the end, what we're trying to do is bring the earth from its hell condition into a higher condition of love. How are we going to do that? By acting hellish or by acting in the higher condition? You can see that we need to get to the higher condition and act in harmony with that higher condition. Now, if we know what God's laws would do in any situation, one way that we're going to assist ourselves to do it is to work in harmony with what God's laws say. And that doesn't matter how much attack you get from others. So someone will go and say to you, so for example, let's say I'm that person and I removed this person because they were projecting anger, rage, condescension, control, they were belittling, they were personally attacking other people on the forum, not even myself, right? And in fact, if it was myself, I'd be having a bit longer of a process about it before, but if I observed it with somebody else between two other people, then my process is quite short, like instant decision. Right? But if it was towards me, then I would at least have to go through some emotions about it first, right? Because I realise I attracted that somehow, and what am I attracting it to learn? So I'd have to consider these things. But let's say I'm this person, and I removed this fella, right, from the group. So I've removed his influence. Isn't that a good thing? If he has no desire to come to this condition of love, which is what I want my forum to be in, I want my forum to at least be in my condition of love, surely. I'm the one who started the forum. I surely would want it to be in at least the condition that I feel I am in. And if I could feel very strongly that he's definitely not in the condition I'm in, my first question to him is, do you want to become more loving? And if his actions and everything are proving that he doesn't want to become more loving, then I must remove him from what I've created in order to maintain the purity of what I've created. It's a must, not even an option, if I really wanted to progress towards love and God. So I remove him. And then all of these other people in the forum who were in a bit higher condition than he was go and attack me for not honouring free will. In other words, they use a divine love or divine truth term in order to attack me. And I go, no, I did honour his free will. He could freely choose to act in harmony with love. And he didn't. Does that make sense? And so what do I do then? I have to honour my own free will by saying, well, you're not choosing to act in harmony with love on my creation. Now, isn't this the same principle as if you were inviting them into your own home? Let's say you invited somebody to your own home. They walked in the door. They started, you know, weeing in the corner, defecating in the other place, you know, like smashing up your crockery. And what would you be doing? Would you be going, oh, free will? Like, now, if he did it to his own house, that's fine, isn't it? He's allowed to do it to his own. If that's the condition he wants to live in a hellish condition in his own house, that's fine. It's none of your business, actually. But the fact that he's doing it in yours, that's definitely your business, is it not? Right? So definitely your business when somebody is harming you in some way in your own place.
Or harming others.
Or harming others in your own place. Let's say they came in and you've got a family of four and you've got a daughter and a son. And this person comes in and they start beating around your son. Like, and this is what's happening on many of these forums, by the way. This is what is literally happening. People come into the forums and they start beating up other people on the forum.
And would you say to your son, you're attracting that son. He's got his free will. He can beat up on you.
Would you do that? No. You'd go, hang on a sec. This is wrong. You need to leave. Otherwise, I'd call the police, wouldn't you? Right? So why aren't you doing the same thing on the forum? And then somebody, all they have to do is say, oh, but it's free will. We've got free will on the forum. No, you don't have an unrestricted use of free will. If you believe you do, you haven't understood any of my teachings properly. The reality is every decision you choose to make, if it's in harmony with love, you have complete freedom. That's the only condition. If it's harmonious with love, you have complete freedom. When it's not harmonious with love, you don't have complete freedom anymore because the laws have consequences that have an impact on your soul and your environment immediately. See, that's not freedom anymore.
It's restricted.
So the freedom is dependent upon love in a lot of ways. Can you see? You're being restricted now with your will, and God's laws have been created for this very purpose so that no anarchy can exist in God's universe. And if you read through the Paget messages, one of the primary things we said over and over again is anarchy cannot exist in God's universe. God made laws that govern his universe. Yeah, and it's great, isn't it? Like,
phew.
it's a great thing. So if I'm this person who's trying, through the best of my ability and current understanding, to have my forum that I created, or my home that I created as a forum, to have a group of people come and learn more about truth and learn more about love and grow in humility and grow in using their faith and growing using their will, and that was my desire to create that particular forum or create the environment in my home as a gift to other people to come, then I have the responsibility to make sure that at least it stays at what I understand love to be. At least that, right? And as soon as somebody else comes along and projects anger and rage and condescension and disapproval and humiliation and reverts to personal attack of other people there, I've got to go, hang on a sec. This is not where I want my forum to be. Now, if you want a forum to be there, you go off and create your own hell forum. Do you see? That's what they're creating, a hell-based forum. Go off and create your own hell-based forum, but leave mine alone. Right? That's freedom, isn't it? You've got the freedom to choose what you want to do, but you haven't got the freedom to choose it in my home or in my under my rules, because my rules I want to bring in harmony with God's rules. Does that make sense to everyone? So this person would definitely remove this person, yes, under those conditions. But these people who then attack the original person and start using manipulative techniques to have this person change their mind to accept this person back, these people have got a lot of problems. They've got just as many, almost as many problems as the original person, because they're actually approving of the condition of that person changing the forum to the hellish condition. So these people, I have a choice, and I would offer them a choice. You've got a choice. You either accept my decision to create a more loving environment for all of you, or you also are removed from my forum. And by the way, that would be the same if you visited my home. You either accept that this is the rule of my home, right? That I want a loving rules to my home, and if you don't accept that, go off and create your own thing in your own home. I'm okay with that. You're just not going to create your hellish thing in my home. You're just not going to create your hellish thing in my forum that I've set up. You wanted to say?
Yeah, I want to present another scenario.
Yeah.
So say, and I'm putting this question to you guys. Say I enter a forum. It has a leader and it has other members. And I enter a forum, whether it's a group on Earth or on the internet or wherever it is.
It doesn't matter if it's divine truth or not.
Whatever it is. Yes, good point. It could be my workplace even, where I have a boss and I have colleagues. I enter a forum, a group of some kind. I enter it. And on entering it, I think, wow, this leader's really not loving. And actually, these people aren't really loving each other. Now, if I truly am in what I believe to be a higher condition of love than these people, what would I do? Floyd, yeah? And then we'll go to Gabriella.
You would have two choices. You could either go out and stay out,
mm-hmm.
or you could try to just stay there and learn what you came to learn or be a part of without expressing anything.
Yeah, there is a third choice.
There's a third choice as well. Yeah. But both of those choices are good choices. They're both loving. Yeah. So if we go to Gabriella, that's your choices.
That's it. So what's
anyone
the third
have
choice?
A third choice? Yep, Dave.
You could go ahead and share what you felt was more loving, and if they didn't accept it, then remove yourself.
Yeah.
When you say
would it
be a forced sharing where you force everybody to listen to you, or would it be voluntary?
Oh, voluntary sharing, just volunteer what you have learned and share that with them.
Yep. So if somebody asked you for your positional point, what would you do?
Oh, if somebody asked me for my position or point, I would go ahead and share that with them.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so if they didn't ask, then I wouldn't really share too
much.
Am
I sorry? Sorry, Don.
Go on. Sorry.
Go.
If they didn't really ask, I wouldn't share very much at all.
So really you'd be reverting to the original positions, wouldn't you?
I would share first and see if there was any accepting of that more loving position. And if somebody came along after that, I would share if they asked for some help.
Yeah.
Sorry, I thought I just kept cutting you off, so I was like, shut up. I agree with you on the point of if this issue of free will is so important under these circumstances, and also your intention. I agree with you when you say if I was asked for my opinion, I would share it readily. I see a lot of problems with people entering groups, believing that they're in a higher condition of love and volunteering what they believe other people should be doing when those people haven't asked. And when already there's an established leader or authority or someone who's in charge of that situation, and then there's not an openness within them to hear from you, then for me, I would revert to Floyd's first two options. Yeah. Yeah. Does that make sense to everyone? Because I think a lot of people miss that.
A lot of people try to force their, you know, they say they're sharing. You know, they get on a forum and they say they're sharing, but really what they're trying to do is force their opinions and a lot of times harm onto other people rather than actually sharing truth with other people.
Yeah. So Nina had a hand up and then Jennifer.
It's just a comment, really, because I feel Corny demonstrated very well in his example what love would do.
Exactly. Yeah. So we're going to read the comments about what love would do because it's that he made, because it's a very important part of setting up any group whatsoever. Yeah. Now, the reason why we're raising these issues with you is because we feel at the moment that almost every group that gets started up by any person who learns about divine truth, a whole heap of very dark spirits move a lot of quite dark people to be attracted to the forum in order to attack it and pull it down to the normal condition of the world. And you've got to expect that is going to happen, right? But what we notice is the response to that is very poor, right? The response to that is there is often a concern about free will, and so then we allow all this terrible behaviour. Or we respond in anger, or we allow other people to back up the people who have free will to be abusive. And these are all actions that we're taking that are completely out of harmony with what God would do in the same situation. Completely out of harmony. And of course, then nobody wants to participate from a perspective of love on the forum. So you get all the people who were first initially attracted to the forum because they felt that it might be a great way to learn more about love and so forth. What do? They all shut up or leave. The majority of them finish up leaving, or they shut up completely. You know, they shut down completely. They don't express anything because they know that every time they're going to express something, the people who are in a darker condition will just attack them anyway. Right? And this is the general thing that's been happening with most groups, physical groups in people's homes, and also most forums. Right? And I feel a lot of it is because the person who created the group or the forum isn't aware of their own responsibility. That's partly the problem. But the other part of the problem is that many of us believe or have a false perception of what has been taught. So this whole thing about free will, many of us have a terrible perception of that. Well, you know, we constantly have issues where we're talking with parents about their children and how they let their children run around like without any form of restrictions whatsoever, right? And the children are out destroying things, breaking things, yelling and screaming, interrupting everybody else, all out of harmony with love. And yet the parents go, oh, well, they've got free will. We've learned about free will, haven't we? Maybe there's something in my soul that I've got to work through. Yeah, there is. You've got to work through the fact that you've got a completely false belief of free will. That's what you've got to work through, really. Right? There is certainly something you've got to work through in your soul level. Right?
What if you privately approached the leader of the group and asked them if they would be interested in a perspective that, you know, an observation that you've had about their group, would that be a loving thing to do?
Of course. Or even, you could even express it publicly if you wanted to. But at the end of the day, if you're unloving or they feel you are, don't be surprised if you get removed. And of course, this is not, remember I haven't said this is not my feelings of whether you have been. This is their feeling because they have the responsibility for what they created. So if they happen to create the group and they are in a first sphere condition, then of course their ideas of love are going to be first sphere condition ideas of love. If they have a desire to grow, if they have a desire to be self-reflective, most of the time they might listen to different people. But what we notice more than often than not is going on is that there is not that at all occurring, but rather there is this allowance of attack. And this is one problem that many of us have. we allow the attack of other people without doing anything about it. We allow other people to attack other people in our own homes and in our own forums that we created. So we're not even setting up some kind of framework of what are the principles involved in this forum. Now, when Cornelius set up, he didn't set up the group. The group emailed whole things out, and the very first response I had was, who's the most loving person in your group? Because if I set up a group and I attracted someone more loving than me, I'd be so happy about that. I'd be going, you sure you don't want to run this group? Right? This seems to be a great opportunity. I would love to learn from you. I would love to know what's going on. I'd really like to know. And if the person's willing to share their time, even mentoring me, like even if they don't want to come along the group, I'd say, look, can you just mentor me then? Like, can I share some things with you about what I'm finding from the group? And you give me some help with that. I'd at least do that. If the person didn't want to leave the group, I'd sort of treat them as my silent mentor on the side if they didn't want to have a more public exposure. And the reason why is because I'd recognise their condition of love and I'd go, this is very, very good. I can learn a lot from this person who has a better condition of love than myself, and they can mentor me a bit in terms of, and if they're willing, you know, it just depends on their willingness, of course. So if they're not willing, then understand. But if they're willing, that'd be fantastic. And most people who are in a better condition of love than ourselves generally, if they have the time, are willing to assist us at least in some way. That's reality, right? So what I would do is I'd ask them, what do I do here? What do I do there? But I wouldn't become reliant on them because then I'd also be out of harmony love myself. I'd be entering in an addiction with them. So I just want to get feedback from them and try to work through things myself right to conclusion, but if I still can't resolve it because I don't understand, then I'd go to them, right? And allow them to, you know, provide correction. But if they were in my group and they were willing to lead it, man, you're the leader now. Does that make sense? And this is what I proposed to the healing group. And of course I said, all of you need to think about. So there were 16 or 18 people in the group initially. I said, all you need to think about is who is the most loving person here? And they all looked at each other, felt each other a bit, decided that Corny was the most loving person there. And without Corny, I don't even think he was present at the time. And so then the request was, is he willing? Is he willing to take some leadership of that group or not? That's the only other question. If he wasn't, then there's this other option, isn't there, of is he willing to mentor the person who is leading? Is he willing to help that person at least? Right? And so this gives you the beautiful ability to be able to check against somebody as well with regard to what's loving, what isn't loving, and so forth. So that would be number one to try. If you've set up the group, you are responsible. Remember, from God's perspective, what happens in this group now, you are culpable for to a degree. So if one person in the group attacks another person in the group and you don't say anything about the unloving behaviour, who's culpable? You are, besides the person who attacked the other. And sure, the person who's being attacked has an attraction, obviously, and the person who's attacking has an attraction, and so do you. But perhaps the attraction is for you to learn to stand up for truth for a change instead of just letting all these bad things go on around you all the time. Make sense? So that's very important. So, Robin? Thanks. Now, we haven't got to the stage yet where we're talking about groups where there's more than one, have we? But, okay. So,
yeah. So in our scenario, one person actually started it, but that was because the email, a lot of people were emailing each other, and we decided it was getting too bulky. So one person...
Yeah, emails back and forth become very unwieldy, obviously.
So one person actually did the work of starting the Facebook, but then immediately assigned four people to administer it. And
all right, so can I first make some comments about being invited to administer? Now the collective condition of those four administers, those four ministering people, determines the condition of the group, doesn't it? So it's a bit more complicated now, isn't it? It's not just my condition determining whatever happens, but three others as well as me determining what happens. Now that means that there's probably going to need to be some consensus between the group. But is that how things are organized in the spirit world? No. No, they're not. How are they organized in the spirit world? And many of you know, Michael, if we're coming around.
Again, it'll be the most loving person.
Good. And so he might have some assistants to help him do more mundane sort of tasks, but in the end, the buck's got to stop with someone who's in a good condition of love. Does that make sense? That's the primary thing. So what the four people who were asked to do administering would do is sit together or have a meeting together, even if it's via internet, via Skype or whatever, and they could sit down together, okay, who of us do we feel, and we wouldn't be going on like, oh, I want to lead this group and be damned, you know, like, we'd be going on a really like honest analysis of ourselves and the other person and what we feel from them. Who of us do we feel is in the best condition of love to administer this group? As the, what you call, you could call them the system administrator or the, in the case of a home, you could call it the group's primary leader, if you like. And then they have some assistants who help them do that task. And they might even have a mentor who's not even involved in the group who helps them, who they can go to and get advice from. That would also be helpful, wouldn't it? Like having someone that they could just email occasionally and say, look, this thing happened in the group. Do you have any comments to offer us leaders about this particular group? Yeah. So there's no harm in setting up the group. The harm is created through our not honouring some basic principles about condition, isn't it? That's where the harm comes. And we're going to, and let's say there's nobody in our group in a first sphere, in a second sphere condition, let's say. But even in the hells, you know that there's thousands of levels, isn't there? There's the darkest of the hells where there's just rage and anger and like, terrible things going on. And the highest of the first sphere is like Summerland. And at least we want our group to be Summerland, wouldn't we? As a minimum sort of a requirement. Now, do you think in Summerland, any rageful, angry spirit from the hills can just go in there and rape and pillage a whole children's block in Summerland? Do you think that can happen? Of course it can't happen, because they can't even get there. So why do we allow such people into our forums, where there's lots of God's children, all trying to be more sensitive and trying to be more loving and trying to be more considerate and trying to be, you know, grow in love and humility? Why do we allow these people who just want to attack, abuse, pull down, denigrate? Why do we allow those people? And we're not talking here about having a different opinion, because the reality is anybody can come into our forum and have a different opinion. There are celestial spirits who have totally the opposite opinions to each other. Did you know that? Totally the opposite opinions. There's a good case in the pageant messages about it, where one guy comes and he says, this is my opinion about what's going to happen in the future, and another guy comes and says, I don't believe that's going to happen, and they're both celestial spirits. They're allowed to have different opinions. What they can't have is an unloving perspective or motivation. That's what prevents them from being in brighter conditions, if we have an unloving perspective or motivation. Does that make sense? So different opinions are fine. I'm not saying don't kick out anybody with a different opinion. You want people with lots of opinions. But it's how we express this opinion in love that matters. It's how we act towards our brothers and sisters that matter, no matter who they are in the world, whether they're in a forum we created or even something going on in the world. Like, if myself and Mary notice somebody treating another person really badly in our seminar, we ask that person to leave, even though it had nothing to do with us. Does that make sense? because we want to maintain as much as we're able to, given what we can see going on, as much as we're able to, we want to maintain an environment where everybody feels free to learn about love and become more loving and more accepting of other people's opinions and more truthful with each other, but also more humble with each other, and not somebody who's going to attack and abuse us and abuse somebody else. We don't want that. They can go away for a while, look at it all on the net, and then when they've worked through their issue of love, come back. Yeah? Or if they want some help from somebody else who's in a better condition, that's fantastic. But they just can't come to our seminar and just project unloving things to everyone else and ourselves. They can't do that. That's not loving to ourselves or other people. And remember that in our case, a seminar is our creation. So we've got responsibility for it.
You know how you taught us that there's these different layers of resistance, basically. You know, you've got your grief is the core stuff, and then your fear and your addictions and your anger and your total resistance, you know, where you're...
Denial.
Yeah. If we were in a discussion of who's the most loving person amongst people who have lots of error, is that a pretty good guideline to say that, like, the lowest condition of love would actually be the person who's still in complete denial, and then the next, like,
correct,
the next worst would be the person in anger, and then
addiction would be the next worst.
Addiction
because remember, anger is when your addiction's not getting met. So anger is just an effect of addictions.
I have that backwards.
So in other words, we notice here going on where, you know, that interaction myself and Mary had where Mary's saying all lovely things about me and I was saying all lovely things about her. We see that going on amongst yourself. You are very close to rage when you're doing this. Because when the other person doesn't give you what you want, what are you going to do? So the addiction is the problem. You know? The rage is the result of you not getting your addiction met, that's all. So it's not that the addiction is the real problem, the cause of your rage.
I see, yeah.
That makes sense?
Yeah.
Good-o. So yes, what you're saying is true. If a person was in complete denial, then they are a person who has no idea about themselves, no idea about anybody else, no idea about really any condition. And when we say denial, what are we talking about? Does that, like, many of you are in complete denial. So what does that say? It doesn't matter how much truth you've heard that's entered your mind. What matters is whether your soul has been open to hearing it. That's the measure of denial. So what we see happening, and Mary and I comment about this quite a lot, don't we, babe, where we see people coming along with a very arrogant viewpoint that because they've heard divine truth, they're better than the rest of the world now. They know more. Well, that tells me they know less now. As soon as you get that attitude, you know less. You're in a less condition of love because you're now judging your brother.
So I showed up.
Yep. And yeah. Still are a lot of times, actually.
This is why I kind of cringe a bit when people say, oh, well, but it's still okay to tell the leader, isn't it? Because I do know the loving thing and they've got no idea. Really, that's the feeling coming out of a lot of people. And it's similar to what Cornelius was saying earlier between the different responses people in his group had between a message coming from Jesus and one coming from Francis Bacon. And everyone had a lot of judgment because of the language that Francis was using. Now, I personally think probably the message from Jesus had a lot more content in it, but I haven't read both of the messages side by side.
You see, I have.
Yeah.
And I feel the whole reason why I gave Francis's message to Corny was I felt it was a very important message for understanding healing.
And yet a lot of people see the language or see the look or something in their history reminds them of something that they did in a New Age past and they go, oh, this is just like that other stuff and where it was all wrong and don't even feel the situation. I've seen that happen a lot with people who have attended our seminars, heard a lot of things intellectually, and they walk out and go back into the world and think that they arrogantly can discern what is loving and what is not, when actually there can be love, a lot of love present at a church group, and there can be a lot of love present at local yoga class, but just because they use different language or use some techniques where perhaps love hasn't been present, then people can get very judgmental.
Would you say that that arrogance that I know I am working with, is that just another addiction, or is it on an even worse layer than addiction?
No, like, it's an addiction.
It's a kind of addiction.
It's an addiction that covers over a lot of internal fears. It's certainly an addiction. The problem with arrogance, though, is that it's very hard to convince a person otherwise. See, with some other addictions, you can sit down with them and say, have you seen this? And if they're not arrogant, they can go, oh, yeah, I can see. But when they're arrogant, there's also this additional blockage to actually accepting the information. That's right.
And a feeling I already know. So it's very hard. There's no openness in that place. Yeah.
Every sixth fear spirit believes they already know all about God's love, pretty much. Now, there's some that don't even believe in God that are in sixth fear, and of course they don't. They would say there's no such thing. They think they already know that there's no such thing. Right? But the reality is their arrogance prevents them from knowing. Even though they're in a really great condition of love, their arrogance still prevents them from knowing. So you can get into a better condition of natural love and be arrogant to a degree. You're never going to get on the divine love path if you're arrogant. Does that make sense? Or you will when you start, maybe, but you're never going to end up at one with God being arrogant. Yeah.
Early days.
Yeah. So at the start, you know, we're a bit arrogant. We think we know this and we think we know that and we think we know that. And the more we go along, the more we realise we don't know. And that is also one of the operations of God's love, is it brings you to the point of seeing yourself how God sees you rather than seeing yourself how you believe you are. So that's a really good thing. So we need to all recognise we're in a process with God, right? But what we're talking about here is we can be even in the first dimension trying to maintain even just a condition of summer land in our group, and we're going to do better than the average group on earth if we do that. Because the average group on earth isn't in the condition of summer land. We're going to do better just by being in that condition. And if we can maintain just that condition, the whole group will flourish, in fact, just like the children in Summerland flourish as they're growing. Right? That's why they're brought to Summerland, so they're protected from the abuse and the violence and the emotional abuse and the humiliations and the condescension and, you know, from that they would normally be associated with on earth, living in a family or living under some other conditions. And that's what we want to create here. So the reason why we wanted to have this brief conversation with you, and we've already gone an hour, I think, or close to, is because we feel that there is a definite need for people who start groups or start, you know, and talking about physical groups or start groups on Facebook or any other medium, there's a definite need for us to consider, firstly, our responsibilities once we start these groups, and secondly, consider getting somebody who you know is in a bit better condition of love to help mentor you a little bit if they have the time, because they might not have the time. And thirdly, that you consider all of the attractions that occur in the group and how you can make the group more loving. How you can make it so that more people are attracted to it and more people feel like sharing and more people feel like embracing the process and more people feel the love present in the group. What you're currently doing is you're allowing the people in the darkest of conditions to boss your entire group. They are having control over your groups, mostly. Right? And any person who criticizes the founder of the group and particularly reverts to personal criticism in terms of, you know, physical criticism of their body, their face, their, you know, all these other kinds of criticisms, which are all engaged to pull a person down, and criticism even of the way in which they're having the group in the group itself, can only expect to be removed from the group in the end, because you're automatically being unloving. If you had an issue with the founder of the group, say in a loving way, this is the issue I have with this group. This is what I notice happening on this group, and I feel something needs to be done about it. Now, if the founder reads that and goes, I don't want to do anything about it. Then you have the choice, as Floyd mentioned. Do you stay and just observe and interact where you feel you want to, or do you leave? That's your choice. And you could choose to start your own group with your own rules if you wanted to, couldn't you? The way Facebook is nowadays, anybody can start anything. I've even had people start Facebook in my name, right? Where there's whole Facebook things that all say, and that they're actually emailing people as if they're me. Everything. I don't know how they get away with that. But we, as Mary has pointed out, we don't have a Facebook page at all. So, but they, you can even get away with being someone who you're not on Facebook, right? And so there's these people, I don't know who they are specifically, we've got our ideas, who are emailing out to, oh, look what I... So if I go to the UK, they write, oh, I went to the UK last week. You know, we did this, we did that. You know, and they're writing all this stuff, and none of it's true, of course, because they never did it. But they're falsely saying, like implying that I'm the person leading this group, right? Not true. But Facebook lets you even do that. If we have Mike over the mic. Mike squared.
I just wanted to comment that I think there's an Aussie Jesus on the Twitter who puts out stuff in your name.
Exactly, yeah.
So for having a group and bringing the whole group up to speed with what you're talking about, I see how you, in a group, you took those five principles of love, faith, truth, will, humility, and applied it to a question.
Yes.
So we can begin to use that. And we can, should we say, if you feel the group, if you feel there's been unloving behavior, message the administrator and let them discuss it like off.
There's no harm in it being public. If the behavior occurred publicly, then discuss it publicly. If the behavior occurred privately, then discuss it privately. That's my general rule. So if I notice someone in here project just at me, I don't come up in front of the group and say that person projected at me. I just sit there with that and I go, like, and I remove the person from the group, but I don't have any public discussion about it. Does that make sense?
Yes.
But if that person did it in front of the entire group, now there is a need for me to do it publicly. Because not only do I need to correct that person and their behaviour, but I also need to correct the group's concept of what is loving behaviour.
Through the example that you're
through these examples, that we're mentioning. And if so, like you said, if you list your basic five principles, so you got faith.
Will.
Yeah. The exercise of desire or will.
Humility. Truth. And love.
So we've got these five things that we've really focused on wanting the group to have. We want it to be a forum to help them have these things, right? So that's what we're aiming for. So every time something we feel is out of harmony with that, yes, if it's public, mention it publicly and see what happens, right? And if you get attacked for mentioning it publicly and nobody deals with it, then you could say, well, the people who are the administrators of the forum not upholding the level of love that you have. And then the question then becomes, do you want to stay on a forum that has a low level of love than you have? And if you do, what are you going to do to help that forum grow? And or are you going to remove yourself from forum and create your own forum that has the level of love that you have? What do you want to do? You have plenty of choices in that.
Unique to Earth Plane is we have a variety. It seems like there's a level of distribution of lovingness and unlovingness, so there's always a reason to stay there because there are loving people that post things and you benefit from and that are really working with feelings.
Correct, there can be. But what I'm suggesting is that forum cannot grow without it becoming more loving. You see, the way, and you may know this about children, right? You know that a little baby child will struggle in its growth if love is not given to that child. In fact, there's been many tests and experiments done where children in orphanages where ones are given love and ones aren't, and to see what happens physically and emotionally to the growth of the ones that aren't given love, and it's a lot harder for those ones not given love to grow, even physically grow, but also emotionally grow. Now, if you apply the same principle to the forum, which is a baby, so creation of, like a child, right? The only way a forum can grow is if there's more love present in it. The only way, in fact, a business can grow in God's organisation, not on the earth. Of course, on the earth, you can grow a lot of things, but if you want to grow things by God's rules, the only way they can actually grow is to have more love present. Does that make sense? So what I'm suggesting is if you get more love into these forums, they will naturally grow. They will become a forum for lots of people to engage in a loving manner with each other without reverting to the general condition of the average internet forum, which is...
the lowest denominator.
Yeah, yeah. And like I've gone to technical forums and it's really... like most... there are technical forums on the internet that have learnt more about love than you have at this point about forums. Like I went on one technical forum and it was discussing the pros and cons of a particular type of technical thing. I won't go into the details of it, right? But the pros and cons of a particular types of hardware versus software applications that I was investigating at the time. And one person reverted to calling another person stupid. And he was kicked off the forum. And the former administrator said in his comment, I kicked this person off the forum and all their comments. And the reason why I did it was because this person demonstrated to me that he had no desire to discuss the matter in a logical and, you know, what he really meant was loving, but he said in a logical presentation of facts, and he reverted to personal attacks. So off the forum. There was another forum I went to. It was an iron ferrite battery forum that I was looking at one point. You know, because I found that a nickel iron forum about batteries that are non-toxic, right? And I went on that forum, and the forum administrator did the same there. They got to a point where they were arguing, and one of the forum members said, in this case, this is a pointless forum to visit anymore because it's just become the personal. Like, every person who posts anything worth watching got attacked by this one person. And this one person was just attacking and attacking and attacking, and he was not removed from the forum. And all of the other people on the forum are saying, this person's a mongrel on the forum. Like, he's treating everybody badly. He attacks everything, and so none of us feel like we can share our own experience anymore. So what was the person complaining about? The lack of love on the forum. And these were technical forums. They weren't even involving spiritual development, which is all about love.
I've got a question.
Yeah.
So this all sounds awesome. I like it.
Does it sound awesome to you, though? Yeah. Would you enjoy visiting a forum that, where you knew you weren't going to get attacked? No? Yeah? Yeah. Would you mind a forum where people were going to say the truth to you without attacking you? Okay. So it sounds good.
It sounds good. Sounds really good to me. Yep. But my question is around what happens if I come onto a forum and people are using words like this, all these kind of words, and it sounds good, but it doesn't feel that comfortable. Or what happens if the condition of the people in the group is being masked by the use of this language?
In other words, the people are not being truthful about what they really feel.
And people are also believing others who are not being truthful because they are using
the right language.
The right language.
Yep.
Or I could go on.
Well, but, yeah. The condition of the person forming the group who's now administering the group is paramount to the growth of the group, isn't it? Because what's going to need to happen is the position of the person who's formed the group is going to need to grow. They're going to need to become more sensitive to what's going on in the group. So Corny was there sitting in the group before he was the administrator of this particular group. He was sitting there in a group, he's going, yeah, there's a lot going on here that's not very good. There's a lot of addictions, a lot of people were saying nice things to each other, but he could feel there were different emotions coming. You know, the guy next to him said, he's okay with having a healing done, when actually he felt quite frightened of having a healing done. You know what I mean? Like, there's people weren't being really open and honest about how they truly felt. Now, you can express your feelings without reverting to rage and anger every time, right? Or any other projection for that matter, without projecting on other people, you shouldn't have said that, or without saying to other people that they've got to make you feel good. So if a group doesn't have to make everybody feel good for a start. In fact, I suggest to you that a forum associated with divine truth would not have the goal of making everyone feel good. It would have the goal of growth. Right? Which means sometimes some people are going to have to be stretched and they're going to have to feel bad. But if there's a lot of fake interactions, who's going to determine those fake interactions are actually happening? Now, if the administrator does not have the sensitivity emotionally to know that fake interactions are happening, and they get a couple of emails from members of the forum saying, look, there's a lot of fake interactions going on in this group, then my first thing, if I was the administrator, would be going, okay, obviously I've got a number of people telling me about fake interactions now, about facades. I need to see this as something that I've attracted, that I'm accepting of facade. Like, I'm accepting this on my forum, so I'm accepting facades. Right? And it's like, remember back to Saturday, our very first day this weekend. Remember, I asked you the question, do you want to heal your addictions? And you said yes. Now, if I accepted your facade and took this week on a different route as a result, would you have learned what you've learned this week? No, you wouldn't have, would you? But I couldn't accept your facade because the previous day I saw Mary put you in the position where some of your addictions were triggered, and none of you really exercised any will at that point to actually address it. So I saw, well, yeah, what you're saying to me, big facade. Right? Now, if I didn't see it, but Mary afterwards saw it, and she came to me and said, look, AJ, you didn't notice, but you know, the day before, I gave them the opportunity to deal with their addictions, and all of them didn't do anything, or most of them didn't do hardly anything at all. And why did you accept their facade? She might ask me. I go, that's a good question. Right? I would then have changed my interactions with you and worked through that issue first for me. But if I hadn't have seen your facade, then we wouldn't have had a discussion this week about addictions. All right? And you wouldn't have got anywhere closer to any of your emotions than when we were at the beginning of the week. Whereas some of you have already got closer to your emotions through that addiction to facade and to being triggered, right? So the beauty of anything to do with God's truth is that if you live in harmony with it, it is going to confront you. You're going to have to grow. There are going to be changes that are going to be required. Everything's not going to feel comfortable all the time. But if the person forming the group or administering the group is sensitive, as Corny is, to his own emotional condition, right, and is willing to act in harmony with what he or she knows to be love at that time, then the group will eventually grow because the person who's formed the group is growing. The group will definitely grow. They'll know, oh, that's out of harmony love now. I can actually feel that. That's something I have to do. Oh, that person was condescending. I need to talk to that person. That's an attack, actually. And I'll start feeling condescension as an attack. That person tried to humiliate that person. I've got to address this person and talk to them about the humiliation. And when they attack me, then... And usually I find personally that if I address something with another group of people, and if they do have the emotion I'm mentioning, most of the time it worsens. Does that make sense? So for example, somebody says, I want to hear some feedback. So I give them feedback. They're in a rage with me. What did that tell you? They didn't want to hear any feedback. They just wanted an addiction met, right? And so now I know by going through the interaction, I know that that's all they want. And I didn't meet their addiction, and so now they're angry, and now they don't deserve to be on my forum for a while. Does that make sense? They work through their anger. They can email me privately. I'll even give them my email address. So you email me privately when you think you've dealt with that, and we'll see about letting you back on the forum. Does that make sense? And it might be a week or a month or a year or 10 years later, you might get a reply. You know, we've had people in our lives come back to us 500 years later. And say, you know, we want to learn about divine truth properly now. You know? So sorry. We might.
I just wanted to say thank you, because as you're going through this, I'm seeing the dynamic of my own family and my own children and my larger family.
Correct.
But this is just gold for anybody in a family.
You
and
see,
we're all
in
some
family. Yeah.
I mean, one of the, you know, recently we had an incident between two daughters. They were both invited for dinner, and one began to attack the husband of the other. And I didn't step in and say, just a minute, that's not loving.
Not on here.
And it just created a horrible thing that is just sitting there festering.
Yes.
And I mean, actually, it's been happening in their lives since they were young children, because we didn't run our home
like
on
this.
These principles.
Correct.
That and that's just, I really appreciate this. It's so beautiful. Thank you.
What we're discussing with you now applies to lots of different situations, not just situations regarding forums or home groups or any of those things. If you applied the same situation in every aspect of your life and in your family, you would find your family would run very much more smoothly. Your children would learn about love a lot more rapidly. They wouldn't revert to unloving behaviour, because they'd know that from your perspective it's not permissible to revert to that. And they would still feel free to work through their own reasons why they feel like acting unlovingly in an environment that is supportive of that. That's what they would do.
So I have one more kind of comment, and that is often I have been a little bit mentoring a few people around this, not just by chance, because we've been planning together and things like that. So I've had some exchanges with Robin, and we've talked about some things, and a few other people. And one of the things I notice is that I'll have the conversation with the person, and I'll say, well, clearly this is the issue of love. And they say, I could have it wrong, actually. And there's suddenly a big backpedal and say, but I wasn't perfect in that situation either. Now, why does that happen?
Why does the person who's the leader
backpedal suddenly happen?
There's only two reasons possibly why it could happen.
So you want to go, Si, and we can go to Catherine, after.
I was just going to let somebody else. Basically, I had a similar experience with you, and when I reflected upon it, I realized that I was actually in addiction and not feeling through what I was actually presenting to you.
So when you did the backpedal, you thought, actually, now that there's a decision or there's an outcome, now I can see I had some ulterior motives here, and that was to get something from me. Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That could be one reason. What could be another reason?
Can we just focus a bit more on that reason for a moment?
There's
a lot involved in that reason. If you think about it, you're backpedaling because you realise you saw your own addiction in the process, right? That's fine, but if you think about it, there's a lot more involved in that backpedaling, because sometimes we backpedal because we didn't really present the information truthfully at the beginning. You see, so sometimes we didn't truthfully present what actually happened; it was our interpretation of what happened, rather than what actually happened. And we've got to take a lot of care with that, don't we, really?
So before we present the scenario to someone or the information to someone, if we're really humble, we're going to look at now, what is my possible part in this? What do I really want to know the truth about this, or do I want someone to agree with me?
And the other question I would ask myself, if I had acted in harmony with love myself already in this situation, would the situation have gotten worse or better? Right? Now, sometimes situations do get worse when you act in harmony with love, or seemingly worse. Mm-hmm. The more harmonious we love you become sometimes, the more truthful you are, and the more truthful you are, the less people like you sometimes. You know, not always, but sometimes that's the case, particularly when you're living on Earth, right? So you can't judge it by the response, but you do have to ask yourself the question. Yeah. So I would ask myself the question, am I truthfully representing to my mentor what actually did occur? Or was I just wanting to get an addiction met by my mentor or an approval for my current course of action? So that's a question that I would ask myself.
It's a good question. And even when you're, even if you're not dealing with a mentor, if you're dealing with someone else where you feel like, I want to seek counsel about this, I want some assistance to reflect on this issue, what's my motivation? Yep. Yeah, good first one.
Can I give another example?
Sure.
Is that all right? Sorry to interrupt. We see this happening when married couples come to get advice from us a lot. Where the wife comes for advice, she tells us a story, and we go, well, if that's the story, this would be our response. And so she goes back to her husband and tells him our response. But he hasn't told us the story. And he comes to us and says, I didn't like your response. And I said, well, what's your story? And he tells a story, and it's like almost a completely different story. And so then you feel like you have to get both of them together and say, what is the actual story? Right? And then I'll give you some advice. And so it's rare for us, Mary and myself now, to give any advice to couples because unless they are there, both they're telling the story. And even then we notice that one half of the couple generally is more dominant than the other, and we see the one that's not dominant going, you know, having his or her disagreement internally, and yet he's telling this story and we go, she doesn't agree with this story, but she's too afraid to even say that she doesn't agree with the story. Right? And if you're sensitive to feelings, you can feel all that. So you go, well, so what's your story now? Yes, you shut up for a while. And then he'll try and tell it again. No, be quiet. I asked her what her opinion is. And then you get to at least know a bit more of the real story. Mm-hmm. Right? So just take care, even in your family, with your children, in groups, where a lot of people have motivations for telling you a story which miss out the most important fact. Does that make sense? Like, we've had people come up and tell us a whole story where it sounds like another person other than themselves has been unloving, and yet when we talk to the other person, we find out that this person has been yelling and screaming at them for 5 days straight. The person with the original complaint had been yelling and screaming. And we go, yeah. Did you yell and scream? No. You yell and scream? Oh, now you mention it. Yes, probably I have. Well, you see, I was very upset about what he did or what she did. And I felt that, you know, he wasn't listening to me. And there's the more unloving behaviour, and yet they missed out all that telling their story. Most people are very unethical when they tell you a story, actually.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, what's the second reason we might backpedal when there's a... Yep, Catherine?
Not trusting myself, usually because of fear. So I don't trust that I even partly relayed the story properly, like that.
Okay, so why? But I've come and I've told my whole big story.
Yeah.
And I've presented what's happened, and then suddenly, when there's a response that's definitive, and often says, "Well, actually, there's this issue and this issue that obviously need to be confronted." Why do I suddenly go, oh, I don't trust myself. Actually, I'm not in such a good condition. I don't really know. Yeah.
I'm afraid of the result that I might get more attack because of that.
Yes, yeah, so I'm afraid to act in harmony with what the truth is in this situation. And often I've had a discussion with someone where something has happened, and that person felt initially, this situation is not loving. And they've tried to address it, and then they receive more attack. And then...
And the attack is an indication of? That it's definitely not loving.
Well, that the response is not loving, but that person could have been loving, yes. if they're sorry, being...
We're getting all confused now. Okay. I'm confused now.
Floyd was trying to say that it's a...
if we got a person...
It's an indication that the feedback was loving, which is not necessarily true.
Not necessarily true. It could have been given lovingly, but being completely incorrect.
Yeah. So if we take the mic over there.
So let's say this is the person who's the leader of a forum or a leader of the group. This is the person who's, you know, this person feels has been unloving. So they talk to them. Now, if this person desires love, would they ever attack? No, they would not. So if they attack, no matter, this person might have said something to them that was completely like up the creek. Might have been somebody else come and whispered in their ear something about the person and it was all wrong. And so the person comes and says something to them.
In good faith. Without anger or a desire to control, but just said, well, I think this is the issue. Yeah.
And then this person responds in anger. You might then say to them, well, look, the reality is, yes, from what it says, what you're saying to me, it seems to me that the actual information I was given was definitely wrong, and I'm going to raise that with the issue with the person who gave me this information. But also the fact is you're now in a rage, so I have to remove you. Because rage is never in harmony with love. And it indicates, the anger indicates the person wants their addiction met. And the anger indicates that the person does not want to grow in love. The anger indicates that the person is willing to attack, even though we didn't know that before. Right? If Mary accuses me of something and I'm willing to attack her because of a false accusation, she never attacked me. She's just accusing me of something. And if I'm attacking in return, who's got the better condition of love? Even though Mary said the thing that was false. Mary still has the better condition of love, right? Because I'm willing to revert to attack. Does that make sense? An attack is an indication of darker condition generally.
And so what I have observed happening is this person, the leader, or the person who's in charge of whatever it is, gives some feedback in good faith. Sometimes because this person has done something that is seemingly very unloving or controlling. This person gets angry back in response. Now.
Or condescending.
Or personally attacking.
Yeah. Personal attacks. Or denies completely that it even was that way at all.
So as soon as those things happen, Jesus has just pointed out what the clear course of action would be. Okay, you're not actually open to looking at this issue, so we don't have a conversation anymore. And we need to look at your presence on this forum or in this group. But what I observe happening often is that this person freaks out. Oh, hang on. Oh. They're afraid. Suddenly something... How can I placate this person? How can I make them understand what I was really trying to say? When already they've shown they don't want to understand. They don't want to know. But this person, in their fear, enters a new interaction with the person.
Which is feeding the addiction.
This person's learning, yeah, I'll just get a bit angry. Everyone shuts up. And this person, you know, is a walkover. And actually, maybe I'm rising to be leader of this group emotionally.
So yeah. This person here is now leading the group. De facto leader now. Because all that the person has to do is get angry with the leader. The leader goes into fear, placates the person. So who's really got control of the group in terms of love now? Isn't it the person who is unloving?
Yeah. Or the other thing that can happen is this person initially starts out feeling like, oh, hang on, something's up here. I just need to point it out, give some feedback. I want to grow. I'm assuming everyone here on this forum would like to grow, so let's have a discussion. They point out the issue. This person has that response of anger or condescension or complete deflection. And then this leader neglects a step, which is about humility. And they can start to get angry in response to the anger. Now what's going on in this group? Who's in charge of this group? Sorry, I'll let you catch up. Yeah. So, yes, well, basically that's what's happened. There's been an initially loving interaction.
So number one is love. They were trying to be loving.
Attempting to be humble and loving.
This person is number two.
Yep, unloving. Now we have an unloving response from the person.
This person gets leaving. Angry about it.
So now who's in charge here? What's going on?
The answer is no one. And when no one's in charge, who's really in charge? The lowest common spirit or person, usually in the place. Now, this is what spirits are trying to do to your forums. They're trying to cause all of you to become unloving with each other and actually destroy any growth of love on the planet. That's their goal. See, their goal isn't to destroy myself or Mary or destroy divine truth. Their goal is to destroy love on the planet and have the planet get into a darker condition even than it already is. That's their underlying goal. So they don't care who gets unloving with whom. They just want to make sure that everybody finishes up unloving with everyone.
And this is why humility as a leader is so important. When we start out with a sincere desire, hey, I want to uphold love, I want to be humble, I want to see what's in this attraction, I'll give the feedback, an unloving response comes, and then we are afraid. We can choose to placate, which puts this person in charge.
Can I even put a step in there?
Yeah.
We can choose to live in our fear and placate.
Yes. Or completely avoid our fear and respond in anger ourselves or condescension ourselves,
yeah,
which puts the lowest common denominator, usually spirits, in charge of this forum. Or we can say, well, this is scaring me.
We can choose to feel.
I need to feel about this.
And then once we've felt, what will probably happen? We'll be able to have another loving response.
Which, if this person has already shown that they're not interested in looking in the issue that you pointed out, would just be to say, you're not interested in looking at this issue. We have a big problem. Because everyone here supposedly has the desire to be humble and look at their issues. So I can't have you on this forum if you're going to be like this. So you give them a chance to go, well, okay, maybe something was going on with me. I can now choose humility. And if they decide they're not going to do that anymore, then why are they still on your forum?
And like, as you know, from my personal interactions with many of you and also from my personal interactions that you've seen with others, I've often had unloving response after unloving response after unloving response come from the same person, right? And if I continue to respond in love, but there's a continual unloving response coming back and I don't do something about that, what is that really showing me? Isn't it showing me that I don't really love myself? And also showing me that I'm actually afraid of upholding God's laws in this situation. I'm afraid of living in harmony with the truth in this situation. So these forums and groups have a great ability to help you grow if you engage them in the right manner. But they have a great ability to destroy your faith if you engage them in the wrong manner. And a lot of the times, most of us are engaging them in the wrong manner at the moment. Right? So we see, you know, we see this happening all over the earth, actually, with a lot of these forums and groups. So the forum gets set up, or the group gets set up, with the right goal at the start, only to be destroyed by the unloving behaviour, sometimes of one person, who affects the fear of the entire group and the whole forum degrades. And sometimes it's just one person. Like, we've seen whole forums degrade just from the attack of one person. Now, if that person's the leader of the forum, everyone else should have left by now and created their own. Do you know what I mean? If that one person who's willing to attack everybody is the leader of the forum, Why would you want to get on a forum from a person who attacks you? And if that one person's not the leader of the forum, why isn't the person being removed? So that everybody else can enjoy a degree of safety and love inside of the forum, just like you would if you were in your own home. So in conclusion, what we would like to do is reread Corny's five rules. Does that sound all right with you?
Whoops. You guys are right over here. Someone had a question, but it went away. Is that, yeah. If we do this, and if there's still questions at the end, yeah. Okay. I'll read, you expound.
Well, I don't know if it needs much, to be frank, because it's pretty clear what Corny's written, I feel.
Yeah. Yep. Okay, so his first guideline is that we have to let go of the idea that we are healers.
So what would that translate to all groups? Basically, just let go of the idea that we are all experts, that any of us are experts, actually. Yeah.
That is the quality of love that does it, that it is the quality of love that does the healing, both inside our own souls and from the spirits that we become in rapport with. And the quality of the spirits we come in rapport with is also due to the development of the quality of love we possess at the time. So the development of love within our own soul is paramount.
The quality of love, and we could say, here we're talking about, firstly, in our own soul, but secondly, in our creations. Whatever they are, a group, a forum, whatever. It's the quality of love that exists that's going to determine its effectiveness, the happiness that it brings to people who are involved with it.
Okay, second. Okay. This group needs to establish the same foundations as the path to God requires. Humility, truth, and love. This is also paramount. Given that God's love is the greatest love in the universe, this is the love with the greatest healing potential and the one that is the focus. As it is a soul-based love, the development of the soul is the only way to obtain it. Hence the first point. Okay. Third, if anyone at present has any unresolved issue with anyone else in the group, that they need to resolve that issue as soon as possible in a loving manner with that other person before they come to a meeting. It is selfish, unloving, and in total addiction to take from the group, to expect others to sit in a room and have to bear with two other people that have an undercurrent of ill feelings going out towards each other, which others in the room have also to bear because of the person's choosing a state of fear and not love for others. Not to mention the darker spirits that will also accompany them. This will not be tolerated.
Now, a person who does not resolve an issue with love privately and chooses to involve any others publicly in the issue is already demonstrating that they wish to have quite dark emotions projected at the person that they're having the problem with. Can you see that? And they also have quite a dark emotions towards the group, because they're basically saying that they want the group to become involved in their own little private war. Does that make sense? So if the general rule was resolve issues with love privately, between people I'm talking about here, the personal, and then only bring them to the public once they're resolved, then it would become sort of more like a teaching thing, wouldn't it, if you're going to bring it to the public? But also, that needs to be a priority before they involve themselves with, in what Corny's saying there, with the group, in this case, with the forum. So if they're not, if they've, one person's got an issue and they see somebody posts a public post and another person has a big response and they want to attack the person who just posted the public post, first thing they will do is try to engage this process privately. And they might send a copy of that, maybe, just as a record to the administrator, perhaps, just so the administrator is aware of what's going on, so the administrator knows. But there's no need for them to get all this dark and dirty stuff out and involve everybody else in the forum in their own unloving behavior. Can you see that? And if they decide to involve others in their unloving behavior, you've got to question whether they love people on the forum, all of the people on the forum. What, it's like me wanting to make you get involved in my personal problems. Is that loving to you? No, you've got enough personal problems of your own, haven't you? Rather than having to worry about one more.
And this is probably where I have an issue with Facebook in general, because it seems like it's all about having interactions publicly. And so if I was thinking about a Facebook forum, and here we've been talking about all kinds of forums, but if I know that some of this started because of issues with Facebook, I would be questioning, what is the purpose of this Facebook group? Is it to deal with issues of love publicly? Because we already know that that's not really going to work. So what is the purpose? Why do we have this group? If it's for people to come on and go, oh, I processed and I received God's love, is that in harmony with the principles?
Isn't the real purpose to share information in the end? An easy way to share information. So it's an easy way to share new information. And so I think it's a fantastic forum for that. The trouble is that's not what happens most of the time. Most people are totally narcissistic when it comes to Facebook. In other words, they share information about their personal life, right? They want everybody else to be involved in their personal life. You know, that's narcissism. That's not information that benefits everybody, unless it's there's a teaching aspect to it. So, you know, we need to question why we get on some of these forums. If it's an information-based forum, and or just a forum of getting assistance to be able to work through issues that you don't know how to work through, then that sounds great to me. But if it's a forum where you're just, you know, you're going to talk about your day-to-day life, well, that's narcissistic. If it's a forum where you're going to help other people, that's fantastic. You know, it just depends on the underlying purpose as to... And this is what the administrator would have to think of. Mm. What's the reason why they created it?
And to be very clear within themselves, their honest intention. Because remember, it's all based around the soul. So if they go, yeah, it's for this purpose, but really they have an addictive desire that's driving it, that will be exposed through the group.
Yeah. Okay.
Four. We will be encouraging people to connect with all feelings that come up for themselves in this environment and to speak up when something doesn't feel right. Constant resistiveness and any anger whatsoever towards anyone else in the group with feedback. Cornelius. Towards anyone in response to feedback or in order to pull someone else down will also not be tolerated, and that person will be asked to leave. Is that right? No, that's all right. I've got two meanings.
Now, just be careful about resistance, because most of you have no idea when a person's being resistive and they're just being truthful. So if you focus first on anger, condescension, ridicule, and all of those forms of attack, the forums would instantly improve without you having to worry about whether someone's resistive or not. Does that make sense? Mm. Yeah.
Mm. Okay, fifth. This will not be a group to sort out your problems. You will need to take responsibility for whatever comes up for you.
So we could say there, take personal responsibility.
Got a lovely last paragraph that I didn't read out before. Can I read it out? These grand rules are essential to provide an environment to any person that truly wants to develop themselves in love. It needs to be an environment that when a person is coming to a group meeting, that they will know that they will be treated with love.
That's what we want, isn't it? People will be able to come along, know they're going to get treated in love while they're there. You know? So if we applied those general principles to any group and to any forum and to any, you know, Facebook or, you know, Twitter or any other thing that we do, and I'm not encouraging all of those things because some of them are highly addictive depending on how they're engaged. If we did that, we could see the quality of the forum would, or the group would markedly improve, and we would rapidly work through individual issues. Like, so remembering the quality of love, the foundation, the resolving issues privately, connecting with all feelings, so that's really being humble, isn't it? Be humble and be truthful. Many of you think you're being humble and you're not being truthful, which means you're not being humble. So you know, on Saturday when I asked you, do you want to deal with your addictions? And you all said yes, you weren't humble then. You thought you were being truthful and you weren't truthful either. Right? Because the previous day had proven that you both weren't humble or truthful when it came to dealing with the issue Mary raised. Does that make sense? So if we were humble and truthful, we'd get through a lot of things in the group and not to sort out our personal problems on the group. Don't dump it all on the group. You know, like if you truly take responsibility for your personal life, you're not going to dump it all on the group. You might ask the group something about your personal life, but you're not going to dump all of your work and processing and all of the realizations you had and all the other things on the group unless you've been asked to share about something that you've learned. You'd probably do it then. Now, if all the groups were brought into harmony that way, we'd have some really lovely groups around the world, I reckon, that would all be growing. They'd attract people, not just people who have heard the truth before. They'd attract people from all walks of life who just come along, and because the group would be such a nice place to be. And there's millions of people on the net that would attract lots and lots of people from the internet just generally because the group is a loving place to be.
But it wouldn't be a group that helped you to avoid your loneliness about your progress towards God or sitting at home in your house. It wouldn't be somewhere you could go and just like suddenly feel like, oh, that emotion went away, or a place where you could feel reassured or validated about the fact that you're getting somewhere if you really inside felt like you weren't. So it wouldn't fill these needs. And I think that things get a bit out of hand because already there's these feelings inside of other group members and they're afraid to challenge issues of love because that would challenge their addiction.
So we would love to see the groups be far more honest about personal emotion without being rageful or angry or condescending or belittling. We would love to see the groups be far more humble in the way they respond to trouble, but also that they have far more goal to actually focus on what is loving here. And rather than having the group degrade in its condition to the worst possible, like, condition through the actions of one person, and we've seen this happen where even just one person allowed to go unchecked destroys the good activity of sometimes many hundreds of others. And just one person can do that. You know, you get a person who sits down 24/7 in front of their computer all day just having internet transactions. And in fact, nowadays, I don't know if you're aware, but there are actually people who purposefully sit in their room 24/7 and they act as trolls. Do you know, you've heard that term? What they do is they go to forums, they register on forums, and then they try to destroy the forum, and then they get brownie points with their friends about what forums they destroyed. Some are actually paid to do it, yes. Yeah. Now, there's no way a troll would affect the Divine Truth Forum if it was run properly. They wouldn't last very long at all. A few unloving comments and bang, they'd be out the door. They wouldn't even exist on the forum. Right? And this is why I feel... And the same goes in a home. You wouldn't let the troll in your home, you know. Throwing around a whole heap of things, destroying a whole heap of things. And you go, okay, it's all okay. It's free will anyway, you know. And you wouldn't do that either. So we wanted to raise these issues with you in closing because we felt you had here in the you have opportunities here, particularly in the States, through the methods of communication that are so free, you have opportunities here to have a lot of interactions with each other and enjoy each other's company, but you also need to take a lot more care about what's happening with regard to the level of love that's displayed in these particular interactions. And we thought if we gave you some guidelines about that, then it would help you greatly in terms of working out what's the best course of action under certain circumstances. Aside from that, we would like to take the opportunity, because that's basically the end of our time with you, to take the opportunity to thank you very much for allowing us to be here. Many of you spent quite significant funds of your own money to get here yourselves, but many of you paid significant funds of your own money to help us get here. Yes. And we would like to thank you for that, because without your donations, all of the people involved would not have benefited. And Corny would like to add his.
Yeah.
I don't really want this. I'm just here to say thanks to you guys.
You never know, right? So we have enjoyed our week with you, and in fact, we feel it's been really successful. We've noticed many of you have made some shifts in your within yourself, and I feel many of you feel the shifts that you've actually made. So that's wonderful. So for that reason, we are going to do it again next year, and we're working through the costs. At this stage, there'll probably be 3 or 4 levels of costs. And
according to the accommodation that you stay in.
According to the accommodation that you stay in. Basically, the highest level accommodation will be around $1,100 for 10 days, and the lowest level of accommodation will be around, I think I've worked it out to be about $700 or a bit under $700 for. And that includes getting all of us back and all of our flights and all of our accommodation, and also Lena and Igor coming as well.
Yeah.
So, and we're expecting, the calculations are at this stage, we're sort of expecting around maybe 100 people or so, but it will be the only place we come to in the States next year. Does that make sense? So we're not going to travel from city to city like we did this time. We'll probably just come here, do the 2 weekends with the week in between. So basically it will be...
About nine days.
Yep. And we are hoping it will be sometime in October, probably the first week or second weeks in October at this point. But we'll be able to share with you what our arrangements will be once we've actually made them. We've spent a bit of time going around looking at things, looking at the problems that people have had in this one, and we want to correct. But we think it possibly will be here, or it may be another location similar to here where we've got about 100 to 120 people can come.
The thing that we look at is if we would be comfortable staying in the accommodations that you have available to you. And for some of the accommodations, did everyone feel okay in their accommodations? Or yeah?
So myself and Mary looked at all the accommodations, and we felt we would be very comfortable staying in the new bunk.
Cabins. So where you've got
and
the bunk
here
beds.
Or in the lodge, but we didn't feel that comfortable with where some of you were staying.
Yeah.
We wouldn't have felt that comfortable there. We feel the level of cleanliness was a problem, so we want to address that. In fact, what we're thinking of doing next time is having a group of people come a day before, and we clean the whole, all of the places ourselves, just to make sure that it's up to the level of cleanliness that we would like them to be. And we feel the food was pretty good, but we're going to reduce the amount of food to 2
meals
rather than 3.
Yeah.
Because we feel that, you know, having a big meal like that every few hours is just counterproductive to dealing with some of your addictions.
And also it gives us the flexibility to, if we have a late breakfast at 10 or something, then we can start a session at 11:30 and run until 4. And then have another session after lunch.
So we have
dinner.
So the lunch/dinner would be 4, and then at 5 or 5:30 we could start another session, and still everybody get to bed by 8 or 9. And what we've found ourselves is it's been a bit tiring for us. So we want to make sure that next time we do it, we have a bit more time
available for ourselves, but also where we're not going to sleep too late. That's been our main problem, or my main problem. Because normally at home we go to sleep when it's dark, and when we've got stuff going on at night, we're going to sleep way, way beyond that time for us. So that makes a big difference to me, because I wake up at dawn, whereas Mary still can sleep in occasionally.
Sometimes.
But I get quite tired with that, so... Yeah. It's important that we sort of restructure it a little, which we'll do.
You've also done an incredible amount of work this week with the technicals, just so much. Thanks. Beyond the brilliance.
Yeah. So what we'll try to do, by having Lena and Igor with us, it will help me a lot, actually. Primarily that's to help me, because that gives me a lot more time available where I'm not doing all these technical things all the time. So after we finished each session, I have to copy off two cameras, I copy off the sound, I have to empty the cameras because otherwise it makes it a lot harder for Igor to edit a whole series of stuff. I make 5 backups of the material, 2 go to Igor, I keep 3. I upload the data to servers, if I can, in Australia, or we send this over that get uploaded. So there's a lot of thing going on behind the scenes for me.
Besides just setting up all this sound equipment and troubleshooting it and all those things.
So having them with us would mean that we would have a lot of those things happening without me having to do them. And then secondly, we have also sometimes things going on where I then can't, you know, I've got to be very mindful that I've got to get certain technical things done before a certain time. And that means that I can't spend as much time with people. And if we have 100 people next time, which was probably likely, you know, that means that I'll have even less time available to do those things. So we're trying to arrange it in such a way that it lessens my personal workload, and that way we can share a bit more as well. But also it means that we can do things like filming and recording some of our discussions when we're at dinner and things like that. Many of you, I think, would agree that sometimes the discussions at dinner were just as important, if not more so personally, than the discussions you had with us here. And that often happens that way. And so having people around who are willing to record those discussions while they're happening is also a great way to teach other people who might have an opportunity to listen. So what we're trying to do is leverage our time so that lots of people can hear what we're sharing. And that way, that means that we don't have to say the same things over and over again all the time. We can refer to things and so forth. And the personal interaction is being recorded. It's fairly rare. We're trying to record more of them, but it's still pretty rare that we get to record many of them. And oftentimes, they have quite a big impact on people, and could have a big impact on larger numbers of people if they were recorded. So that's why we're choosing to do that. So at this stage, it's looking like we will probably try to have a venue. If we can't get this one, we'll try to have a venue that's about 100 or 2 to 120 people maximum. And we're trying to have it so that sort of at least half of those people could be married couples, you know, couples that can be in one room.
Or your soulmate.
Or your soulmate, hopefully, by then, you never know. And we're trying to arrange it in such a way that the costs of getting us here are spread across a number of people. And if we do have money left over, what we're going to do at the end of the presentation is tell you how much money we actually have left over, right? And then ask the people who attend what they want to do with it, but they have to collectively agree to one course of action about what they want to do with it. So whether they want it to be redistributed back to themselves, or whether they want us to use it for the next another year, or whether they wanted to use us in Africa, or wherever they want us to use it, that's where we'll use it. So that's our plans, our general plans. We have about 10 volunteer-type positions open for next year if you want to help us come and clean up beforehand and stuff like that. So we'll let you know those things as we know them ourselves. We're hoping to finalise all of the preliminary arrangements by 2 weeks' time. So and then give you a good solid 4 or 5 months before you have to make a cut-off decision. And as I said, we're planning, if it's here, it'll probably be in October. And if it's somewhere else more north, it'll probably be September or something like that. It will probably be rather than September if we do it somewhere north, of these warmer climes. So that's our plan. So hopefully, and who knows what will come of that next year, we'll just see. It does mean also that we have the means to leverage our time a bit, which means that we get to see more people in less time. And when that happens, that gives us more freedom to actually do more FAQs and more other things that we would really like to do as well. So it's a great way of us having our time available to us at other times to share with you. So we'd like to put that to you as an option for if you want to come next year. And we feel if the way it's working at the moment, it should all work out to be in amongst those price ranges around about. Yep.
I've really enjoyed getting to know all of you a lot better and appreciate your company.
Yeah. And we've enjoyed being with you for an extended time, actually. Yeah. Because that way you get to know each other better and you get to see, you know, people in different situations, don't you? Yeah. So thanks for making it possible, guys. And thanks.
And thank you for your donations in addition.
You've been very generous to Corny and ourselves. Yeah. So we'd like to thank you for that too. And we look forward to seeing you next time, which if you don't come to Australia or go to somewhere else that we travel to, we'll probably be somewhere August to October the next year. Yeah. No worries, guys. No worries, guys. Thanks for your company in the last week and a bit. Yeah. And, it's been fun getting to know you. And we often, when we leave, we often think, we'll think of you very affectionately over the coming months.
How are they doing? How's Lawrence with that mum stuff?
Sometimes you might notice us in your sleep state or notice us come around when we're asleep because you're awake then and just try to help you along the way. So if you notice us do that, just say hello. We'll be happy. And then we'll be, in terms of our plans this year now, basically we're going home. We'll probably have about a month or 6 weeks home. And then we're going to probably go down to New South Wales for a couple of weeks. There's a lot of new developments happening there at the moment, which the guys we can't tell you about at this point, but might be very interesting developments happening there. So we just want to spend some time with them about that. And then we have not made any plans beyond that, but we suspect that now people know that this kind of thing can possibly happen, that there might be a bit of that happening around the world. And in fact, we are considering, after we come here in October, or before we come here in October, that there might be a European thing that's very similar.
We'll just see what desires
come up there and do that. We've decided that we're spending less time doing public seminars and more time presenting FAQs and other things like that because we really feel that we want to get a concentration of truth that with very little distractions out to the world and be ready for what we feel is going to be steady growth over the coming years. And the only way we can really help or assist that growth is by giving people as much information and answers as possible. And so that's what our primary focus is, really. And your donations will help us do that, actually. And so that's why I would like to thank you for your donations. It helps us do a lot of things at home. At home, we're actually next year building a little studio at home so that we can... At the moment, we record in Lena and Igor's... lounge room. They have a big, we put up, so the whole lounge room is taken over, in other words.
Permanently, and, pretty much.
And because they rent their property, obviously,
they don't rent.
But they don't own their property. In time, they'll lose access to that property probably. And so we want to be ready for that too. So we want to have a studio at home where we have it permanently set up, where we can just record. And so we're hoping to record both video and audio there on different things. So that's one of our priorities this coming year. So we'll be spending a bit of time doing that at home. Yeah. Anyway, that's our plans. I'm sure your plans are just as interesting as ours. No? Yeah? And I feel for many of you, if you embrace the principles we've taught this week, you'll find you have some major changes in your life over the next year. Yeah. And if you don't, get a year's time, and instead of punishing yourself for it, just go, well, I didn't choose to do much that year. And allow yourself to be honest and truthful about that as to why, you know, because every time we choose to not grow, generally it's because we're angry about something. And so just let yourself feel about those things if that's what happens. But thanks for your time, guys, and I've got to get myself started to pack now. So catch you.